A junior fellow at Harvard is sort of king of the hill. He can go into any department in the university for 3 years and work on anything. And I worked on several different things in those 3 years. And I started thinking about how would you make a computer think. I got a lot of theories about that. I started to write them down and balance them around. And I guess I finished this set of little theories by 1961, and I published this big paper. And I never had any problems after that, because that paper was, everyone in the world looked at that and said, oh, that is the right thing to work on. I'll do this part. And the paper had about 15 or 20 different things that had to be done. And I just lucked out. It became the standard, and the language I used for describing the different problems got to be what everybody, because before that it was a mess. I always felt that I lived in a golden age, and anything I did, people would say, yes, let's do that. And partly was that, starting in college and graduate school, I really focused on mathematics. I became a good mathematician. And so when I started to suggest that people work on artificial intelligence and these, I invented neural networks and things and different ideas in psychology, and I noticed people would tell each other, well, that might sound nutty, but he's a good mathematician and he's proved these pretty good theorems here and there. And so if you go into a new field, it's very nice if you, I mean, it's sort of fake, because generally when a mathematician goes into psychology, they screw up. Around 1963, some friends of mine went to the government to organize the future of information processing. There were some very visionary people. The first really useful computers only started to appear around 1960. There were a lot of computers in the 10 years before that, but they were very expensive. And so one of my professor friends, who had been a teacher of mine at college, went to Washington, and he organized this Advanced Research Projects Agency idea, which led to the internet and parallel computing and all sorts of things, just starting as early as 1963. And he decided he would give me $1 million a year. The government was very loose then, and some smart person in the Defense Department could just start a project. The Cold War and everything. Mm-hmm. And suddenly this $1 million a year started arriving, and that was a lot of money. And there weren't that many people in the world to hire. So again, I was living in a golden age. If some young fellow would come with what looked like a pretty good idea, I'd get him. It took a while to work up to spending $1 million a year. And if there were, most managers have to say, well, we've got to make a choice. We can do this or that. I never had to make a choice. I'd do both. And it wasn't until the middle 1970s that things got more constrained, and you couldn't do any old thing that you wanted, or both. Another thing I should say is that I never liked making management decisions. And when we started the artificial intelligence project around 1958, I started it with my old friend from graduate school, John McCarthy, and we just co-directed it. There wasn't any director. The two of us would run this project. Somebody would come in and say, what should we do, or could we do this? And if I was there that day, I'd say yes or no. And if John was there that day, he would make a decision. We didn't always decide the same thing, but we each could simulate how the other one could think. And then 5 years later, John went west to California, to Stanford, start another laboratory. And luckily, another marvelous person, Seymour Papert, appeared that year. And then for another 10 years, we co-directed the thing. So I think people are crazy who try to run a laboratory. And as far as I know, every other laboratory has a director, and that person usually becomes scientifically unproductive and runs out of ideas. And after a few years, the director of a great laboratory is a big liability, because he's lost touch. So But I never managed anything myself. I'd get another person who thought almost the same way, if I had trouble making a decision, I wouldn't worry about it much. And, you know, different people are good at different things, their judgment was probably better than mine, we learned to know what each other were good at. So I don't understand modern politics or industry or something. I think these guys who try to run companies are just plain nuts. They're not very good at it. In the great fields of computer-related things, there wasn't very much management science all those years. But still, these big companies would get stuck, and they just lost flexibility. The top people who had been pioneers 5 or 10 years before just went to sea. You could see Xerox, which had developed a wonderful computer that later became the Apple. Its managers didn't understand that, and they said, oh, well, IBM's doing well, let's make PCs. And Xerox vanished from the... They couldn't even make a laser printer, even though they had invented the Xerox machine. Well, actually, Papert and I tried to write that theory for many years. Mm-hmm. So it must have started in 1962 or 3. by 1975, some of the ideas had developed, but we were having trouble organizing it. And he sort of turned into the field of concepts of education and how humans learn and so forth, and wrote another book, and I drifted off, and I worked on this Society of Mind book for about 10 years. But in the meantime, every 2 or 3 years, I'd get some new theory and publish that separately as a... and eventually they became chapters in this big book. The idea is that the mind is a highly evolved, very complicated mechanism and it very rarely has just one way of doing things. And that's where it seemed to me psychological science got stuck. People would say, well, does learning work this way or that way, or is memory organized this way or that way? And it seemed to me that clearly people, if they used any particular way, no matter how good, it would get stuck on some kinds of problems and you'd have to switch. So what we were doing in making the Society of Mind theory is saying there's got to be a command and control hierarchy, or not hierarchy, there's got to be a lot of different ways this thing could work, and different parts of it have to know when they're doing badly or they have to have critics. And actually I'm finishing a new book about how the mind works, and this book is called The Emotion Machine, and I think it's going to explain to everyone just what emotions are, and it turns out they're very simple and very complex. Mm-hmm. An emotional state is just a particular way of thinking. If you're angry, you think in a certain way. It's not that there's thinking and emotions which flavor it. It's that there are different kinds of thinking. So if a person's angry, it means that there's some problem that's bothering him, this situation that he's got to do something about, or she, and you have to do something pretty quickly. You're going to turn off all your wonderful resources for figuring out what's best in the far future. Maybe you'll turn off most of your mechanisms for doing comfortable, smooth, graceful social relationships. And if this guy is annoying you enough, maybe you'll just hit him or insult him or do something that people would say is very emotional. But from the point of view of the parts of your mind that are still working to solve this problem, these are just the right things to do if you're in a hurry. So most emotional behavior has evolved. These different subsets of how the mind, your mind will work, have evolved to be quite good at handling particular situations. And so people say, well, what is emotion? It's so mysterious. The answer, no, it's so trivial. We just give these emotional names to the different ways people have of thinking. And the same for consciousness. People say, what's the mystery? What's consciousness? The answer is there isn't any such thing. We're not very conscious to begin with. You don't know how your mind works. You don't know about the 400 different brain centers. But some parts of your brain, like a computer, are pretty good at remembering a little bit about what the others did in the last 2 or 3 minutes. That's very useful, because if you're solving a problem and get stuck, then this part of the thing can say, well, I see what went wrong. You tried this and it didn't work, and you kept trying it. That was stupid. And so it seems to me consciousness is this set of about 20 different things you do when you get into trouble. They all depend on keeping some records of others of what you did so that you can recognize, or so that this part of your brain can recognize that this was a bad pattern and it wasn't right to react that way. So you take this big bunch of ideas and say, how do I make a big machine with hundreds of parts that's so resourceful that whatever happens, I mean, person never gets stuck like a computer, which jams. If it's really frustrating, the person will just change the subject and say, well, I'm gonna have lunch, or I'm gonna take a nap. I don't see anything mysterious about it. It's if you try to take these hundreds of wonderfully highly evolved things and say, there's a thing called consciousness that does that, then of course it's a total mystery. But that's because you're asking a question. Here's all this complicated stuff we do. How could a little round shiny ball with no interior do all that? The answer is, I don't know, duh. People who talk about consciousness are, to me, people who say, duh. People don't have the slightest idea about how they do reasoning, and intuition is a polite word for guessing. And some people think that there's some special kind of intuition which gives you the right answer in a magical way. And you just follow one of those people around and you'll see. A friend of mine followed a squirrel around for a whole day, which is very hard. And because he was interested, how does the squirrel do these wonderful things of leaping from branch to branch? Well, turns out they fall out and they fall off a lot. He watched this graceful squirrel and in an hour it missed a branch and it just barely managed to catch a lower one and didn't bother it much because it's very light. And then later in the afternoon, it fell all the way off and dropped 30 feet. But didn't bother it much. Right. And so if you're looking for a miracle, you'll never get anywhere. But if you're looking for intuition, which is a name for hundreds of ways of guessing, and you're realistic and say there isn't any real intuition, then you'll find the 50 pretty good ones. Oh, I think when I was a young child, I was terribly interested in how everything worked, and some of my first reading was in the science fiction area as well as science, so I ran across the short stories of H.G. Wells, who was the Isaac Asimov of the previous generation. And my father was an eye surgeon who did all sorts of research on in medicine, and there were chemistry books and physics books and math books around the house, and I think ever since I was a small child, that was what interested me most. Well, I think I was very interested in many fields of science, chemistry, biology, mathematics, physics came later, but those things seemed very wonderful and clear, and I was a kind of electronic amateur. I build radios and other gadgets. Good. High voltage spark coils. Oh, I had many good teachers, and I got attached to a different one each year, I think. There was a chemistry teacher who let me use the laboratory in fourth grade, and all my life I've just wherever I was, I would find some person that I admired and try to learn to think the way that person does. Well, I went to the High School of Science in New York, and that was full of wonderful things. Here was a high school. It was in the World War II period. It was full of PhDs, refugees, all sorts of marvelous people. And when I got to college, that seemed a little bit of a step down from the Bronx High School of Science in New York. Well, I never had a sense of direction, but I knew, always felt that it would be wonderful to know how physics worked and how the universe worked, and it would be nice to know how living things worked. And I think somewhat later, it seemed to me that understanding how the brain works or the mind works was probably the most important and interesting problem, and nobody seemed to know much about it. Well, physics is hundreds of years old. Archimedes was pretty good at it, and Galileo and Newton made major steps, and so in the 20th century, physics was several centuries old. Biology came later, but there was quite a lot known. But in psychology, it's a wonderful field, which only started a few people around 1850, and even by 1900, there weren't very many people making good theories. Sigmund Freud, who I read when I was a child, was the only one who seemed to have a kind of architectural idea of the mind is made of many parts, and he made speculations about how it works. As soon as I got to college, I ran into people. There was a wonderful young mathematician named Andrew Gleason, and I met him when I was a young student. We used to have lunch, and once I asked him what he was working on, and he said he was trying to solve a mathematical problem. It's called Hilbert's fifth problem, about the relation of topology to geometry. And he described this problem. I couldn't understand it very well. And I asked him, well, how do you plan to solve that? And he said, well, I think there are three main steps I'll have to do. And he described them, and I dimly understood them. I said, how long do you think that'll take? And he said, well, that's about 8 years, because this problem takes 3 years, and maybe this three, and that should take two. And that's how long it took. And I followed him around. And you see, some people go to classes to learn what the teacher tells them. But unconsciously, and I don't know when I started doing this, if I liked how somebody thinks, I would listen to them, but I wouldn't pay so much attention to what they were explaining. But I'd think, how did he get that idea? How did he think to explain this or that? And sometimes I felt like a kind of vampire. I'd meet these people. Gleason, George Miller was a great psychologist, Warren McCulloch, in later life, Richard Feynman, and many wonderful people. And I would just hang around. When I found one of these persons, I'd hang around them for months or longer, and whatever they said, what state could I have been that I would answer that way? So I have sort of a library of these people. Maybe novelists do that when they make up characters in their story, but I have a little population of different scientists, and Seymour Papert and John McCarthy were two others that I worked with for years. And I got into the state that if somebody asked me something, I would think, well, what would John say about that? What would Papert say? Gradually, I came to the point that if you see something, you should make three or four explanations of it and then thrash it out between them. Because in psychology, there isn't one reason why you do anything. There may be dozens. And so you have to cover the field with these different theories. It's a very popular subject. It's not very well defined, so but there must be more than 100,000 scientists working in that general field, and some of them are working on trying to make computers solve particular kinds of problems, and they write new kinds of software called expert systems. The trouble with those is they're good at one thing, but they can't do anything else. Well, the theories that Papert and I developed earlier, and he was mainly responsible for a lot of ideas about thinking in education, and these have had some impact. He has a big following. The theories I have about how to make a big thinking machine are still being debated, and there's only about half a dozen people who are following these right now, but I expect we're competing with some very big fads. There's 40,000 people working on something called neural nets, which I invented in college, and fussed around with for 4 or 5 years, and decided that was those things could do something, but they weren't very good, and in many ways they're a dead end, because when a neural network solves a problem or recognizes a pattern, that could be useful in practice. But if another part of the machine tries to reason or think about how this part did it, there's nothing, because a neural network ends up with just a bunch of formulas and numbers, but no articulate explanation of why it worked. It's a very valuable engineering tool, but it's very limited for theories of psychology, because large parts of the brain do things that way, but they're not accessible to reflective thinking. And so if you get good at doing something in that way, then you can't even explain how you do it to your students. So it's very useful, but it doesn't lead very far. And then there are 4 or 5 other big fads in artificial intelligence, and each of which have, like, people who say, can we do common sense reasoning by using mathematical logic? And there are about 10 or 20,000 people who specialize in that. It's hard to believe. And they slowly make progress, a little bit every decade. But I don't think it's going to come to much, because it's something that people use only in very rare emergencies and only very few people. There's a fellow named Aaron Sloman in England who's has very similar theories to mine, wonderful theories. There's Doug Hofstadter, who's rather well known in Indiana, and he has a lot of ideas that are similar to this. And another researcher named Douglas Lennett, who has a company that's trying to develop a system somewhat like the kind I'm looking for that does common sense reasoning, but only 5 or 6 people in the whole world. So any student who wants to get into psychology, right now the students are like lemmings. They say, well, it's popular to study brain science, I'll do that. Or it's popular to do neural networks, I see 30,000 people doing it, must be good. And my advice is, if a lot of people are doing it, don't waste your time. They might be right, but of the 30,000, only 5 of them will actually, the rest might as well not be there.